council, and we have a couple of city councilors here. If you'd like to wave, please. All the way in the back, Tom Monahan, sitting in the shadows, like the phantom of the opera. I would also like to thank the leadership team. If you guys could raise your hand and be acknowledged, thank you guys all for participating. We've had people from various wards, various advocacy groups, and then folks that are experts in transportation and urban planning and real estate development and open space and culture and all sorts of activities. So, so here we are tonight. As we begin our discussion of the blueprint, tonight opens a 30-day public comment period where we're accepting feedback from people. We prefer it to be online as opposed to wrapped around a brick and thrown through my window. But thank you, Tim. We have access to this document both on the city's webpage, in the planning department. So if you go to City of Brockton, if you go to government, departments, planning, you'll find a copy there under a blueprint for Brockton. Also on our webpage, which is www.ablueprintforbrockton.com. And that will have all the documents and links to other reports and things that have been done in the past. And you can see how this project has moved forward. So, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Rob May. I'm Director of Planning and Economic Development. And with us is Steve Cecil with the Harriman Group. And they are the lead consultant on a team of some fine experts that we've brought together to help us facilitate this. But the vast majority of the plan was written by you. We've had dozens of meetings all across the city. Hundreds of people have shown up. Just not tonight, but we've had a really great participatory process, and all the PowerPoint presentations, all the notes, all the maps, everything that everybody drew or doodled on is also on our Blueprint for Brockton page, so you can see how the plan has progressed. So, with that, here's our agenda for tonight. We'll have to project, unfortunately, the microphones and PA system. We're not connected up, but I don't hear anything about poor planning. So it can start with our agenda.
Sounds good. If I stand up, can you see through me to the, I don't know if you can really see anything, but can you see the screen okay?
Yeah.
All right, very good. Well, again, I'm representing a group of people as the principal at Harriman. I've had an opportunity to work with a great group of people from a variety of consulting companies, FXM Associates, experts in economics, BSC Group helped a lot on transportation and open space and natural resources. And the McMahon Group is a very interesting and helpful transportation planning group. What we're going to do is talk through the basic structure and content of the master plan and set the stage for your review and eventually implementation of the ideas that are within it. I should say that by way of introduction, there are in fact several different documents. After thinking a lot about it, the first document, this one, the white one, white cover one, provides a kind of summary. It's very concise and hits all the key points. And if you look at that and read that, you'll capture the gist of everything that's in the plan.
Nice and slim.
And then the meatier volume here, the one with the blue cover, has the detailed discussion of what we call the planning elements. And the way that a master plan is put together is according to the requirements that the state puts together. There's a law that says that communities really should be putting together comprehensive plans on a regular basis, and those comprehensive plans have a certain number of elements to look at. It's not just one. There are, in fact, 8 elements, and you need to address that to make sure it meets the state requirements. And at the front end of that, there's a vision, and the back end of that, there's how you're going to implement it. And that's how we've structured the entire process. So the benefit of having an adopted master plan, which is the responsibility of the planning board, the state laws really interesting. It says the planning board should be responsible for the planning document. Not to mention, though, that having the endorsement of everything from the office of the mayor to the city council to all the boards and commissions should be aware of what this is about, because it's up to everybody to take the ideas in and see how they can be turned into reality. Now, from there, one of the things that we wanted to emphasize that Bob's already mentioned is that this has been a highly participatory process. Who has been at the previous meeting about Blueprint for Brockton who's here this evening? So I'm speaking to people who know and have been part of this process. But in order to make sure that we've reached out and start to think about all the different dimensions of the Brockton community, we've prepared reports that look at the background in these topics. We've been studies of what other communities are doing. We've been out in the community and the wards listening to people and listening about their considerations. We had a series of community surveys. Then as we started to focus in on these 8 different elements, we had a series of 3 workshops, October, November, December, at the end of last year, where we really dug into what the goals and what the recommendations might be. We've been meeting throughout the process at key points with the leadership team, people who represent different dimensions of the Brockton community. So we're at the point of having the draft report and meetings associated with that headed towards planning board adoption. Now, the first part of planning really has to do with vision.
Okay, and the vision we've spent a lot of time on, and we've had a lot of participation in. And normally, we've all been to presentations like this, and somebody reads the slide word for word, and it drives me nuts. However, this is one of those things that we really want to have you guys take a look into. We have this on our website for you to download. It's available in English, Spanish, and we're having it right now translated into Cape Verdean Creole. We are hoping to find someone who can help us translate this into Haitian Creole so that we can get our major groups covered. But we want to emphasize in this vision, this is Brockton in the future. So think of us 20 years from now, that Brockton will be valued and increasingly recognized by everybody as a high quality place to live with that's affordable and what are some of the other? And we offer all dimensions of a 21st century city. And as we go on, as you see through this presentation, Brockton is a whole city. And that's an interesting concept to roll out, because if you go to other places, you'll find places that are, you know, what they call bedroom communities, or other places where the real is all about work. There's no play and nobody lives there. Brockton offers the live, work, play, shop experience. So we really are standing head and shoulders above a lot of communities around us. And our vision, I hope, will continue to allow us to prosper. We'll grow with new businesses and land redevelopment. Attracting the benefits that the community offers, both urban and residential neighborhoods. And we expect to see Brockton really take its place back as the center of the Metro South region, or the much larger South Boston region. So there's great character here that we want to build on, and we think that by working through this with innovative uses of land, mixed uses, and providing services that attract walkable districts will really cement our place in the future.
And from there, the vision starts to articulate. These are just a few key phrases they're pulled from what does that mean in terms of some more specific ideas. I think it's extremely important that the vision recognize that Brockton has an opportunity to be really economically strong, beginning with downtown, but the other commercial areas as well. And in mixed use, which is what a 21st century is, first century city is the key. But balancing that, what you have and will have in the future are fantastic neighborhoods. Having safe, stable neighborhoods are really important. Where you're going to be able to put yourselves forward as a 21st century city, though, is by thinking about where entrepreneurial businesses and jobs are going to come from. You're in a fantastic position relative to regional access. The rail is here in ways that isn't in other places. And even though it can feel congested in Brockton, it's actually very well connected to the regional roadway network, and you are very much better off. And you really have a fantastic range of opportunities that no suburb has, and very few cities have in terms of the cultural resources, the character of where things would be. So having a growing network of places, people, and being sort of plugged in is really an important idea.
So as we move into the chapters, or what we call elements of the comprehensive plan, they're required, of course, by state legislation. So there's a land use chapter, there's an economic development chapter, there's a housing chapter, there's open space, blah, blah, blah. But as we went through this process, we noticed that there are some cross-cutting themes that tap each one of those particular activities. And we felt it was important to use those themes that were developed by the group as really an organizing principle. So those themes are: restore land use balance. We want to focus both on restoration and preservation of our neighborhoods and development. We also want to be a great community for the middle class. Here we say that we want to focus on the three R's. We want to retain the middle class that we have. We want to retrain the people who aren't in the middle class yet so that they can move up into the middle class. And then we want to recruit some people into Brockton, some new entrepreneurs, people who are providing new services, but to basically grow our middle class. Stewardship, expanding stewardship is very important. And stewardship is about ownership of your community. We want people to say that this is my neighborhood, and we can see people who have done that around the Keith Park Neighborhood Association, or the Edgar Park Neighborhood Association, Campbello Business, Montello Business, but you feel a part of your community, you feel like you own this, and so you want to pay more attention to those certain areas. And also with stewardship is you becoming more involved with the decision making that's going on here in the city. Getting involved in communities, advocating for certain projects, making sure that your voices are heard. And then the last cross-cutting issue is providing equity. And equity is obviously a very hot topic these days. And we're not just talking racial equity or social economic equity, but we're also talking about geographic equity. You know, as you know, the city is divided east side, west side. And a lot of decisions seem to be made that favor one side of town over another side. And we need to make sure that as we implement this plan, as the boards that are making planning decisions or zoning decisions, or city council itself, we need to consider the geographic equity so that everybody is touched in a good way by economic development activities, by job creation activities, and by the restoration and preservation of our neighborhoods.
So, going back to that earlier slide, if you think about it, we're trying to find how each one of those themes, cross-cutting themes, will tell us how to implement these different elements. But the categories themselves are very, very useful as a way of organizing the thinking and the information. So we're going to go through those eight different elements that you see listed on the screen.
And you'll see in the plan, when we start each chapter, each element, with those cross-cutting themes, and we say how each element is addressed in that theme.
So there's some specific goals that we start out with that came from all those community meetings and the leadership team meetings. And part of this, if we're going to rebalance the land use, is to take the underutilized land and bring in new development with a particular focus on the job creation and opportunities that are part of it. But in order to do that, there's some really interesting actions that come along. I mentioned earlier that you are unusually well located relative to the regional transportation system. And the areas around the train stations, Montello, downtown, and Campello, are ripe for becoming a very different kinds of places to take advantage of that. It can reinforce and strengthen the existing uses, but add uses. So using that, again, using where you're leveraged with, the new services are only been in place for a couple of decades. The region is getting so congested that that's what's happening. But part of this is making sure that the activities don't get focused on this new development or the downtown alone. This is that equity idea. Spread the investment so that where it's needed in the neighborhoods, your great strength, that's how things should work. It's really interesting when you look at the land use patterns. So this is a map of the existing patterns using some traditional zoning categories, residential, commercial, industrial, et cetera. And you know, what happened with Brockton is that there was a shallow valley that runs north-south and Main Street runs along. And that's where the low land was, that's where the water was, the factories came along, the rail line, 1846, bang, it goes down in alignment. And you can see it in the way. You can really see how the combination of industrial, commercial, the red stuff, the more intense housing, of course the downtown is here. But then what's happened with the Route 24 is that then the automobile rather than the train starts to drive what's going on, and the areas around the intersections build up, and then the arterials to connect those begin to be the places where development occurs. The predominant pattern in the city is the neighborhoods. You are a very developed city relative to other places, so when you're thinking about what's going to happen, you need to think about how do we take the next step in effect redeveloping some of the underutilized areas, because that green stuff that's up on the screen is either parklands or preserved lands or open space because it's wetlands. With the exception of a couple of significant areas, significant sites, pretty much everything has had or been developed in the past.
So as we look at Brockton's land use in the future, what we want to be, and this is, again, coming from the community, we're looking at it through a different lens. And in modern planning terms, we're calling these transects. It's a basic way of, if you were to slice the land in half and take a look at it from the side, what does it basically look at? And it's about how the properties around you interact with each other and interact with the public realm. So we're looking at creating some or reclassifying some of our land uses, new kinds of concepts. You'll see around along the Route 24 corridor, around the two exits. If I could get the pointer?
Yeah.
Oh, it's right here. So these areas around the interchanges on Route 24, we've identified these as potential areas for high-density mixed-use development. And mixed-use, in this case, we're meaning commercial and office uses. We want to see jobs creating in these areas. We also look at both the Campello, Montello and the Campello train stations as being great places for what we're calling transit-oriented villages. This is the way that the community originally grew up 100 years ago. And so we're going back to the future in a sense. We see downtown again as a high growth district. You can see some areas for expanded industrial and industrial commercial, and then along the major arterials, we have opportunities for neighborhood and neighborhood supporting commercial and commercial corridors.
Now, the other opportunity for mixed-use innovative development is, of course, the fairgrounds. And it's hard to imagine that as a fairgrounds alone is how that land is going to be developed over the long term. There have been continuing studies and discussions about it, but we're making sure that it's an area of focus. So from an overall development standpoint, what the plan says is let's make sure that we're focusing on multiple places and that there needs to be a series of targeted studies and zoning changes that are much more contemporary in terms of the way that zoning works. And I'll just give you a few examples. In the past, the great big shopping malls and big commercial areas like Westgate Mall started out as parking lots with a cluster of really big stores in the middle. What's been happening is retail is changing. The owners begin to realize that people don't necessarily like to go to a place that's just a parking lot with a store. And so you're seeing in a lot of different places, and if you go up a new development that's starting to really come along, is the University Station project up in Westwood, which is up there. And it starts out, of course, there's a big grocery store and other stores, but there's housing, and there's offices, and there's park space, and there's walkways, there's going to be a hotel. Other things are being added, so it's a much, much more intensive use, and people like to go there to do more than one thing, or live there and walk there. So the land assets that you have are good, but as Rob points out, if you can think about land being fully occupied, but if it's fully occupied by one-story buildings and great big parking lots that aren't used very much, it's very low-density jobs, and it's very low-density value. So you have assets that can and will change in the future. You need to find ways of filling in between the places that are there today. So there are a series of recommendations, and not surprisingly, the goals and the recommendations are aligned. And in the master plan, you'll see these expanded upon. But the overall idea is to make sure that while we're focusing on a series of specific places and keeping those, we have to keep a balance. Don't put not only all your eggs in one basket, but pay a ton of attention to the character and quality of the neighborhood, because that's the foundation of what the future is going to be.
Economic development.
Yep.
We look at it, it's really important that as a community we work to create more jobs and good paying jobs. And there's areas for redevelopment that include the CSX yards, there's around the Route 24 exchanges, and potentially redevelopment of the fairgrounds, depending on what that turns out to be. The Metro South Chamber of Commerce produced a study that gives a wide variety of options that we really should be looking at. We need to promote development of land and sites in underutilized areas of the city. There's a lot of places that could use investment. We need to find a way to incentivize investment in those neighborhoods. We need to change the perception of downtown. We're starting to do that, we're starting to turn the corner. And we've had some long-term tenant, champions, basically. Let's say champion. You know, with people like Bill Hogan and John Marion, who have made investments in our community and who have really helped make downtown a great place. We also need to promote neighborhood scale, mixed use, rather than auto-oriented, really trying to create the sense of community, knitting the community back together again. We need to provide training and education so that all members of our community can move up into better paying jobs and employment opportunities. And we also need to provide programs and actions that direct and support entrepreneurial and small business development, especially in our minority and immigrant community.
And one of the things that you can sort of look at parts of the commercial and older industrial areas and say, well, there's a, down the map a little bit, the rents, there's empty space, the rents are relatively expensive. Fantastic, because within the Boston region that is growing and where small businesses are trying to find places where they can get started with low risk, you have a fantastic asset on your hands. And this is an interesting map. If we take a look at where Brockton is, within the region right here, the Regional Planning Agency developed a map that says, well, we've got, of course, the urban core, and then we have the mature suburbs that are pretty well developed out, and then the rural areas are still converting to suburbs. And here's Brockton, right on that border. But if you look at it compared to where some of the other big cities, the older industrial cities, the Lawrences and the Lowells are, you are so much closer to the center of the region and between that Route 128 and 495 band. So you are so much more convenient relative to the other kinds of places, it's not even funny.
So as we make recommendations, we want to, again, promote land and sites in underutilized areas. We want to continue to revitalize downtown. There's a lot of effort and energy going in down there. We want to promote redevelopment of auto-oriented corridors. How do we soften the edge of the strip mall? How do we also backfill? As retailing changes, a lot of these big box stores go away. They get filled up with lower quality tenants. How do we make it so that there's a redevelopment opportunity there rather than just a backfill with schlock? Professional term. We also want to provide training programs. We work very closely with BayWIP, the Brockton Area Workforce Investment Board, and their partners, and including Brockton High School, the Southeast Regional Vocational, and Massasoit Community College, in providing training to move people up that ladder. And I know, we all know, that Brockton High School is a tier one high school. We are the only gateway community that has a tier one high school. That says a lot about Brockton.
I just wanted, before we move on to the next segment, I want to underline that this is a master plan. It tries to draw in and endorse the other important planning initiatives underway. You have a very strong and clear downtown action strategy and follow-up urban redevelopment plan for the downtown. You are set up very well with the basic tools, but what we need to recognize is that those tools will, over time, what's going to happen is it's taken a long, long time. It can take 20, 30, 40 years to get it downtown. You're about 20 years into it to get it back, put back together. But as it becomes successful, it starts to really roll. So what we are suggesting is that looking even beyond that action strategy, you're likely to have to expand some of those areas. And as soon as you get another one project done, you got to be looking for the next one. So it endorses that initiative in a very important way. The housing in Brockton, one of the really interesting characteristics of your community that's unlike others, the average length of occupancy, people stay in this city for an average of 18.6 years.
Do you know how long somebody stays in Holyoke? 18 months.
Wow.
And the average in the U.S. is about 7 years. In the United States, people pick up and move all the time.
People want to live in Brockton, and when they're here, they stay. We put down roots, we grow old, we raise our families. I was looking at him, I'm sorry.
but that's an unbelievable opportunity in the future. Then you need to stop and think about it. For the people who get that great high school education, get the job, if they stay in Brockton,
we or if we can bring them back.
In some communities, as senior citizens, people, the kids go, they sell a house. If there's a great place to stay, there are many, many benefits. So part of what we need to do is to take a look at what you have and expand the range of housing choices. And this is where rehabilitation and renovation, living in loft type spaces, or people who have a small business that can live where that is, those lifestyles are really important. And your overall proportion, this is another really interesting idea. We've done a lot of studies of what makes a good, stable neighborhood. And the answer is, if you have about 50% ownership and about 50% rental, that's actually pretty healthy. Because there are a lot of people who aren't in a position to buy, and maybe it's not right for them. But if it's all rental, it's all housing, you don't have any choices. So you're right now at about 46% ownership and 54% rental. You're really close to that balance. I'm sorry, the other way around.
55-45-ish.
Yeah, you're really close to where that balance is. So again, you want to make sure that you have programs that are supporting the homeownership side, and expanding some of the rental will be fine too. You're amazingly balanced as a community.
So you can see from our goals, we need to emphasize market rate housing. We need to continue to reinvest in our communities to stabilize our neighborhoods. We've got great historic properties. Our triple deckers are incredibly popular, but we need to continue that reinvestment effort.
This map is quite interesting. It represents how the city developed again. Around where the old factories were in the downtown, that's where your two-family, three-family, and some of the multi-family mostly, that's the orange stuff. The single-family lies a little bit further out. Other communities are trying to get this pattern going because the multi-family, particularly where there are services and shops around and things, are great. But one of the things that you have very little of compared to the communities are the large-scale housing developments, and you see those are the big orange patches. Neighborhoods tend to work better when there are lots of little buildings that line up along streets and that they can be bought, sold, improved, rented, and your mix is really very good.
So we have what people want, and to prove this, if I needed to, City of Brockton is, again, number one in single-family home sales in the greater Boston area. So, and this is our third year in a row of doing this. So people are investing and people are buying in Brockton.
So having zoning that allows for a range of building types, these are some small, almost townhouse type, but not quite. You may know this is down by Campello, or the conversions of the former industrial buildings. All of those innovative types add to that choice in that mix, and that's where we're headed with housing and the recommendations. Now, taking a look, open space and recreation. What we heard pretty clearly is, for the whole, on the whole, you actually have a pretty good supply of parks and places, but boy, it's time to refurbish them and bring them back up to speed. That's the fundamental message. Let's make sure that we find ways of bringing the dollar resources. It's understandable that in the past they start to run down when budgets are short, but we need to start thinking about how to bring not only additional dollars through embedded programs, and some of them are listed here, but this is where stewardship really comes in. If neighborhoods, or if a company in town, or if an individual will get involved in 8-part, 8-corner, adopt it, watch after it, advocate for it, help you get some program going, you'll be in great shape. And in the midst of all this, you have one of the most spectacular parks in DW Field that's in the entire region. It's an amazing asset. And building on that and around that will be part of what your open space and recreation future is all about. So the recommendations about the open space are pretty clear. It's a matter of creating better maintenance, better opportunities, but also starting to reach out a little bit more into the neighborhoods themselves. We heard a lot about the idea of having community centers, but that may not be so much formal community centers for a while, but what can you do to start having programs that young people, that the families can enjoy, maybe in the schools? Can we do something different with playgrounds? Can we partner with organizations and associations?
And I think this is about. I think you see really good examples of that here in Brockton with the Edgar Park Neighborhood Association, with the Keith Park Neighborhood Association. They're programming public space. They're taking it back, they're claiming it, they're bringing activities, and just, you know, even on a shoestring budget, they're making cool things happen in the neighborhood.
So this is not unrelated at all to the notion of the natural resources in the city, and also the cultural resources. And so that's one of the elements of the master plan. The idea of taking the open space that you have and making sure that it is environmentally successful, sustainable, and resilience is a big idea these days. Climate change, despite what maybe said, is something everybody's planning for, because you can see that the storms are increasing and that stormwater's a problem. You've got to stay up on top of your stormwater systems. But we can do things with natural resources. We heard again and again the notion of urban agriculture. Urban agriculture is, again, exploding. You're very well positioned to take advantage of that, and we provided some ideas about how to follow up on that. As far as the cultural resources, what we've heard a lot is how do we bring the cultures that we have here out into an environment where they can be shared? How do we expand those opportunities? And how the heck do we get a theater in the downtown? And other kinds of things. There are places that people can easily add to the list of things they do in that space that's part of what it's doing. Your historic assets are a key part of your future, and you're going to have opportunities to protect them. So what we found is that you have excellent resources in many ways. Building better regional connections to those is going to be great. The community culture is really quite diverse, it's really rich compared to a lot of communities. The question is how to make more out of that. So the recommendations follow along to figure out how to get those goals done. But if there's one thing that I think there's an important cross-cutting link to those original objectives, is it's about stewardship. It's having organizations, entities, whether it's the Historic Society, whether it is the invariant society, whether it's the churches, it's beginning to get people more and more to recognize that you are a citywide asset in a way, and how do we reach out and do more together.
So NCA really wraps it up. Engage the community. That's critical for us moving forward.
And you may very well find that in the downtown and other places where entrepreneurs come into play, people who are artists and cultural small cultural associations, small places like Brockton, are beginning to expand.
And you can see that happening on Dover Street, where an old industrial building is being converted into artists and studio space. It's a beautiful gallery on the first floor, and events happen there. And it's the kind of place that really is starting to turn around the neighborhood. And I hope that we can provide work with the community to provide additional spaces like that.
So in terms of the services and facilities, the master plan does an inventory and looks into the future of those facilities. You should know that in order to meet some of the key goals, everybody that was involved in the project, talking about services and facilities, seemed to continue to underline this important theme of public safety and the reduction of crime, the perception and the fact of safe places to be, and that translates into making sure that you've got appropriate staffing to meet standards, but also appropriate facilities.
So if I could, yes, we need to increase the number of police officers that we have, that comes out in our report, but it's not just about the number of uniformed officers, it's how they're deployed and how they interact with the community, and you know, community policing is a very important strategy. Also on the same side, it's in the stewardship vein, it's about neighborhood watches and knowing who your neighbors are, and keeping an eye out for people. So again, it's taking back the park that is in your neighborhood and making sure that you're providing an extra set of eyes that help the city, that help the police department take care of problems before they start.
It's important to know that Rob and his team are directing a complete comprehensive facility master plan for the city. So once again, the master plan's job is to pull all of these things together. There are a few important points about this. In concert with downtown revitalization, the police station, a future new police station, a future better fire facility, organized in a way that contributes to the downtown revitalization as part of what can happen. But you also have some surplus facilities, schools that are no longer being used or used in very, you know, for storage and that sort of thing. So what we're saying is that when you take a look at those properties, you, as a city, you're spending money holding on to things you don't need. But when you release them, make sure that what they're doing is contributing to the quality of the places around them and the quality of the development. Don't just sell them to the highest bidder. Make sure that they are creating value and directing what
supports
happens.
The vision for what we have in here.
And finally, in terms of programming for various kinds of services, let's see if more of that program can be distributed to be in the neighborhoods rather than just in one place. Because in today's day and age, if an event or getting to an after-school program, an evening program is 5 minutes away, it'll get really used to be a service to the neighborhoods. So those are where the recommendations line up. We are going to make sure that municipal facilities plan becomes the hard numbers of where we should clean up, fix up, and replace over time. In terms of your infrastructure and utilities, you have some issues in terms of aging.
Don't we all?
Smokes are aging too. But on the other hand, being a complete city, you're starting from a point of a really complete infrastructure system. It's a matter of organizing the upgrades, and you're headed in very positive directions as far as that goes. Most of our recommendations are about modernizing the way that you are getting information, organizing and prioritizing improvements over time, so that when you have aging, it's like an old house, you tend to spend weekends fixing the thing that broke last week. What you need to do is step back and say, what do I need? What do I need, and when do I need to put it together so that I can budget it properly and put it in place? And they're brand new computer programs and ways that you can get information about exactly where issues are going to be so you can organize yourselves better.
So DPW and the new city engineer has started this process. We need to encourage them so that we have this information on maps electronically. Right now, if you've been back and seen the vault that has thousands of paper files, and one gentleman who sits back there who knows absolutely everything, and we need to get his mind into the computer somehow.
That's exactly right. So those are the kinds of things that are built into the recommendations. Most people, I think, find this stuff boring. I find it hard to sometimes concentrate on it, but as many people remind us, this is the basis of the success of cities. They have a very strong, clear infrastructure. Just because you can't see it and it's underground doesn't mean it's not important. It's the master planning process and what you're going to do with that. It's going to be part of being a healthy city in the future.
It's also the utility system that is going to help us survive as climate change happens. As we get heavier and heavier storms, we 100 years ago, we turned all of our rivers into culverts and we filled in our wetlands. And so, it sounded great back in the day, but now we have to find a way to move that storm water into areas that is, can expand safely without damaging people's homes.
And because of its importance, the master plan element, in a way, transportation is the infrastructure for moving around. but it deserves its own discussion. And the planning element around transportation recognizes that as a city, you have great opportunities to build your pedestrian and bicycle connections because you're not a big sprawling suburb, you're just the opposite. And in moving into what they call complete streets that look at all the modes and emphasizing transit, a consistent theme has been to see if there is any way to make, and there are ways, to make the downtown circulation more successful, more convenient. And generally speaking, seeing what you can do to continue to be highly convenient, connected community through the Route 24 and the arterials and the rail. I think that one of the things that's very clear in our studies is that there are areas of congestion. In most cases, though, there are actual solutions that are available out there where you've got the bottlenecks along the corners and the difficult intersections. There are ways of improving them that they have to be planned for. And as new development occurs, you need to make sure that as new development happens, the improvements to the roadway systems happen at the same time. The pedestrian network extensions are really important. There are not much neighborhoods that don't even have sidewalks in town yet. There are others that do. So basic idea, let's make safe places for people who walk to and from school, to and from the shop, and each other's homes in a way that makes sense. Definitely the relationship between the downtown and other places as far as transit is concerned is positive. So overall, the recommendations are get down into a level to talk about constantly monitoring and tweaking the system to make it work better, expanding the range of choices so that people can hop on a bike, hop on a bus, get to the train. Your big competitive advantage is those multiple modes. But overall, to make sure that it's an integrated system so that all of the users can take advantage of it.
And remember, one of the fastest growing transportation segments is electric vehicles. And I don't mean the Tesla, I mean the hoverounds, the little mobility scooters. As my generation, as we grow older, we're starting to, you know, we still want our freedom. And so we're looking for a way around town. So how do we make sure our streets, our sidewalks and streets accommodate all forms of traffic?
Now, the thing about a plan like this is it doesn't compel anybody to do anything. It sets out a vision and it shows how you can head in the directions that the community has defined through the process. And there are going to be a number of different roles here, from the city leadership, the elected officials, city council, planning, and the planning board certainly has a role. But the other commissions do as well. City staff, folks like Rob, Shane, and Pam have places to play. We're suggesting, though, that in terms of building stewardship, maybe what you should begin doing is starting to pick out these topics and form citizen committees to work with the leadership and work with the boards so that there gets to be more consistent focus and more people involved in that. And if we can expand the number of people who are involved and find a place, whether it's what do we do in terms of additional recreation programs, what are we doing in terms of the downtown, that's clear, but Montel and Campello as they start to shape up. It's great to have people directly involved in the implementation and working in other towns. It's always been interesting to see that people will step up if you give them a chance, but you have to give them that chance. So the kinds of stepping up to the table that the members of the leadership team did is just an indication of where you can head. There are a number of tools that we've listed. There's an implementation matrix that lists a number of tools that you have available. I just want to end my presentation before Rob wraps this up by saying that you're well positioned again as a community You're not a small town, you're a big city, and you've got big city tools, and you've got a big, the ear of the state leadership that a smaller community doesn't have. As a result, the tools of things like the redevelopment authority, participation in Gateway Cities programs, getting the attention of the MBTA, these are things that you can do. So you have a lot of tools, but you are going to need to find the time and the resources to use them. As somebody who has rebuilt, I'm an architect and I rebuild portions of my house, and I like to collect tools. And I can see those tools in the corner sometimes staring right back at me. But I know I've got to pick them up at some point if I'm going to finish the job. So that's the next step in the process, and we're looking forward to your input and help.
Steve, thank you and your team for working with us. It's been great to have you, but ultimately, this is our plan. All of us. It's our community, and it's important. There's three of us in our office, Pam, Shane, and myself. We can only do so much, and that's why stewardship is so important. We've had some great leaders in this community who have stepped forward and taken a hold of a neighborhood or a corner and you know, done something. But for, you know, especially the people who are watching this on video, if you've got a great idea, do it. Work with us, but you need to take the lead on some things also. So I challenge, you know, the Field Park Association, the other neighborhood groups around the area. You know, if you don't have a neighborhood watch, start one. If you don't have a neighborhood organization, you know, get to know your neighborhood and neighbors and start that. If we're all working in the same direction, I think we're going to be able to get over all the little things that are in our way. As you heard from this report, as you'll read, through this thing, there are incredible assets here in Brockton, and if we're all working together, we can use that to our advantage and really make Brockton a great place for ourselves, for our children, and for future generations. So I want to thank you all for coming out this evening. We'll take a couple of questions, but primarily we want to get feedback in writing so that we have a complete record of all of this. It's important for us to be as transparent as possible, and by doing the writing, it's just that much easier. So if anybody has a couple of questions, yes, sir.
When you put together such an impressive plan as we have put together, what impact does it have on the tax rate for individuals who own homes? And what impact does it have on the businesses that I hear will be coming to Brockton? Per your experience, maybe from other towns that have successfully implemented similar plans.
That's a very good question. And for those of you who didn't hear it, it's with an aggressive plan like this, how does it affect homeowners, the tax base, and what kind of things can we expect about this? For the most part, government is running around and we're looking at our tax base as a pie. And we tend to divide it up differently depending on who's in power and what the priorities are. But there's never enough pie to go around. What a strong community plan like this does is doesn't just simply divide the pie, but it makes a bigger pie. And if we go out and look at what we have, especially in some of these vacant parcels, and how do we recreate development or how do we incentivize, you may lose a little dollar here or there in the beginning, but in the long range, if we're looking at this, we have the opportunity to really create a much stronger, financially sustainable Brockton that is less dependent on state revenue and supports the families and individuals who are here living here now.
I think that from a tax-based standpoint, the focus of this plan is to take land assets that you have unused as commercial land assets for the most part, and to be an incubator of new business, and that's where the new development should be. But that does is it increases increases revenue without putting additional burden on residential owners. That's what's underneath a lot of this. That's what we talk about balance. Right now, an enormous percentage of your tax base is in your residences. You need to shift that tax base based on new businesses and new opportunities come in. Now, in some ways, the landowners are going to be able to rent or sell their property for more money, and they'll pay some more taxes. But they'll be making more money to pay those taxes, and that's really what's underneath all of this. So that's what this notion of balance is. You don't want to develop available land for commercial uses at the expense of the residential. You want to do it the other way around. And I'm sorry about that. That's my fault.
So that was your fault.
No, it's my wife. I'm sorry.
Yes, sir.
I had a couple things, but I'll get over it quick. Well, don't worry. Over the years, the city planners have came up with some good ideas. Rob's been here about 2 years now.
Yes, sir.
He's had some great ideas, in my opinion. What happens is we come out of these meetings, community meetings, the city planners over the years come up with the plans, and then they get changed. They get, I'm not going to use your word, but anyway, they get changed. So why are we having community meetings all these years? I've been going to them. Not one community input meeting has the plan actually came out of the community meeting. Not one. And it goes back 4, 5, 6 years. So I'm all for community meetings. I think the community should be involved. But in my opinion, every single one that I've been involved, I'm not saying I went to every single one, but every single one that I went to, the plan was not followed. Not once. I'll give you an example of what just happened a little while ago, and I'm actually pretty happy what did happen, and that was the Walker Playground, where the original plan was for a soccer complex. I was against that. I'm not against soccer, I'm just against this big, huge complex in the neighborhood. Well, now it's going to be a baseball field, which I'm for. Except what happened to the original plan when we said we were going to talk about a soccer complex? I'm using that as an example. You follow my thinking? I'm just using it as an example.
Yeah.
So I'm happy with what happened with Walker Playground. I have no problem with that. But we have these inputs, we have these plans, and then it doesn't become a reality. There's a lot.
I think it was General Eisenhower, President Eisenhower, that said, history doesn't judge you on your plan A, but how well you execute your plan B.
Right. But what I'm getting at is
plans are fluid.
Yeah.
So what we've done, we didn't say, go block by block and say this has to be this, and over here it's this kind of tree. What we've done is we've set a vision for what we want to be, and a series of recommendations to get us there. And I think the success of plans is the ownership of the plans by the people.
Right.
You know, we've had a long history in Brockton of the same group of people who get together and they produce a plan, and this is, oh yeah, this is it. And then, 2 years later we have another mayor and we put together another plan, and oh, this is it. And it goes,
yeah.
It's because nobody believed in that. Nobody else was involved in it other than those 12 people. And I know you participated in the downtown action strategy, the urban renewal and the DIF down there. We had several hundred people involved in the process. And that plan was then brought to city council. But what makes that unique is not only is there the action strategy, which is the vision and the desire of the community, but there's also an urban renewal district, which is the authority to implement that plan, and then the district improvement financing, which provides some of the seed funding for implementing that plan. And working with Robert and other property owners downtown, Robert Jenkins, I'm sorry, the Brockton Redevelopment Authority, we're implementing that plan. We're moving forward on that. And as we have here, we've identified some things that we would like to do. The city planning department is going to be implementing some of those things. There's other elements that we want to work with you to develop, and whether it's, you know, the next park that comes along, or a Campello master plan, a Montello master plan, the 12 other corridors and neighborhoods that we want to work in. It's about ownership of that plan by the city. It's not Rob May's plan. It's not the mayor's plan. It's not city council's plan. It's all of our plan. And we're going to be the ones to pick it up and move it forward.
I just wish one of the plans that I had put in had some input. Just one. It's like going out 30 times and nothing happens 30 times. Just one time where the plan came from the community that was followed up. And that was my point. The history of Brockton, the history of downtown, the demise of downtown Brockton. You touched on a little bit, Steve, with the industry.
Yeah.
Well, industry is mostly in the north and the south along the rail yard. But there were a number of factories downtown. But what really killed downtown and then eventually Brockton was moving the venues themselves out of downtown, the high school, the police station, the post office, bringing even the buses. And there's other things, private things. Everything went out like this. The mall was an automatic because of the highway. The mall developed next to the highway because they were trying to attract people from outside of Brockton, not the Brockton people. The venues themselves brought the people that were in Brockton out of the center of downtown. So we have to reverse the trend of moving everything that's good in downtown Brockton outside of downtown Brockton. Very happy to find out the farmers market's staying put. Found that out today. It's a little thing. It's not going to change the whole city. But I had heard that they were contemplating moving that out. I was handed the flyer today, staying right where it is. So my point is, the venues that are there, the good ones, the library, my place is coming along. Johnny Marion's, you know, the businesses that are there, Paul Pretentious's place, the businesses on Legion Parkway. We need them to stay there.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what really killed it. Not the industry leaving, that left the whole city.
These are the cards that we've been dealt.
Right.
And we either play this hand or we fold.
And I'm not all unhappy with this plan.
I don't see 95,000 people folding.
Yeah,
where we're going to go. So let's play this hand. Let's draw from the deck and bring in some new cards to this thing. But let's keep rocking and moving forward.
Hi, Rob Shetterly. One quick question. I didn't quite grasp it in the beginning where you said you could find a copy of the draft where you have these three websites for the three different departments. But what you just showed us in the synopsis on the screen tonight, which would be the best one to access for somebody that wasn't here tonight?
We will put this PowerPoint presentation up there also. But the easiest one is the blueprint for Brockton, the draft master plan itself, which is a 34 page document.
With pictures too.
With pictures, that's correct.
So
under a blueprint
for
Brockton? Yeah. Either on the planning website or a blueprint for Brockton.com.
Thank you.
It'll be at both locations.
And then there's lots more to dig into.
We also have a flyer kind of broken down where the best places to find electronically are, as well as really physical copies that library will have at City Hall. Someone is supposed to come in and treat City Hall as a library. And on the back side of the flyer, as Kurt mentioned in the comments, ideally we'd like them in emails. But if you want to, you know, print out one of the electronic copies at your house, you know, scribble all over it with some comments, we'll gladly accept, you know, a copy of it.
So as Shane was saying, there will be hard copies, you know, obviously at City Hall. We'll have them in all three of our libraries. We'll have a copy of the Council on Aging. We hope to work and leave one. We have to ask them. But we hope to have one at the Boys and Girls Club and the YMCA, and hopefully at offices of some community-based organizations like Brockton Area Cable Access, like the Cape Verde Association, or the Haitian Community Partners, or does NAACP have an office?
NAACP.
Do they have an office?
No, we have a meeting place.
a meeting, but we'll leave it wherever we can find a place to tack it to a tree if we have it. But we want to be able to have people see this. I want to give this gentleman first.
Hi, Mark Osborne. In terms of incubating and attracting new businesses here, one of the bullet points mentioned fiber optic. And I know, I think it's either Nashville or some town in Tennessee has been very successful by having a municipal fiber optic system in terms of attracting businesses. I work in Mansfield, but they have a municipal electric company. And I know that when we moved there, I think I worked for moved from Newton to Mansfield, that was a big attractive feature because it never goes down. And people that work on that live in Mansfield, they know every nook and cranny of that whole electrical system. So how feasible is it for Brockton long-term to consider having a municipal fiber optic system and a municipal electric company, which I think would be great selling points for the market?
Well, I think it's very feasible. We're talking about municipal fiber optic and even potentially Wi-Fi or something similar to that. We have this huge backbone that runs through the city, and I call it Cambridge quality high-tech cable. High-capacity fiber runs through the city, and it hits some of our schools, but it doesn't get its way out in the community. And I would challenge our administration and our city council as we continue to negotiate the cable contract to make sure that Comcast or whomever takes over our cable system is upgrading our community to fiber so that we can then hook into that high-capacity fiber. And we're also working with DPW as we make street improvements. Whenever we open up the streets, we should be laying conduit so that we can then push fiber through. So as we tear up Center Street in a couple of weeks, as for those of you who don't know, we're rebuilding Center Street and a new intersection at Center and Montello. We'll be laying a conduit underneath there so that in the very near future, we hope, we'll be able to go from the high capacity fiber that is at the CSX MBTA rail line and run that through Center Street and then up and down Main Street. But that's the starting point of the network. But it's knowing that it's there and it's putting the tools in place so that we can make this easier, that we don't have to tear up the streets all the time, that if it's there and we work a deal with the provider, we need to get them to put it in place. But it's very, very important.
It's one of the specific recommendations under infrastructure is to pursue that with the first step is to see if the carriers that are out there, you can create what you need, but you need to have high quality, high volume, and you've got the trunk line here, so absolutely.
I mean, Vios is like drinking out of a garden hose. This stuff is fire hose. It's 100 times better. And if we can get that spread out in our community, we're going to be able to attract entrepreneurs and people who are working with data and image processing and some really cool things. So it's high on the change is over time. It may be fine for 8 years, but then
kids
grow with the house.
So, so I think that as we take a look at that and take a look at the demographics, that's where you're looking at maybe additional multifamily housing or housing for seniors. You'll be finding spots where you can add things and being flexible in how this is where reusing some of the older historic buildings communities have been really helpful because they can find there's so many different ways you can provide them up. You're starting in a pretty good place. You've got a lot of variety and a lot of choice, but choice is the point.
Street, let's say that after five stations, you cannot have the rights. So how do you plan to make this two ways, given the hope according to your visions, you just have the language to run around?
Well, our goal is to work towards a two-way Main Street downtown, and that includes Warren Avenue, so that we improve the circulation. We have the traffic jams in the city because people are all trying to funnel through a specific area. We also want to encourage people to spend more time downtown, to park on the sides, not in the very heart of the city, but along the edges. And then once you're out of your car, do multiple stops. And that also means having more people live and work in that area. So, Councilor, I'm going to let you have the last question because it's getting to be 8 o'clock.
We'll stick around.
I wanted to ask the consultant.
Sure thing.
Other communities, how have they ensured that continuity of commitment to a plan? Have they done something different? Have they created some formalized structure that would outlast any political administration or office holders? Is there something that can be done so that, as Bill Logan mentioned, we don't have a report and
right.
Someone comes along and throws it on the shelf and we never really see progress?
Yeah, it's really interesting. We've worked in a community now for 25 years, Norwalk, Connecticut, and I don't know if you know Norwalk or not. It had some real economic challenges, and their downtown is just finally taking off after a long time. Excellent neighborhoods. What we found is that a few things were important. I'll stress that not only the planning and community development side of things was consistent over time pretty much, but the redevelopment authority mechanism is what cities have, and they can provide a kind of steadiness to what's happening. If you look at Boston, Boston Redevelopment Authority was a huge part of its success, and people don't remember sometimes, Boston was the poorest city on the East Coast in 1970. I mean, it wasn't the UPID, there was nobody down in this, on those streets. I mean, it really was different. But that kind of steady thing. And then I think another aspect of it really has to do with this notion of stewardship. A few people and a few associations. You have a population who stays here that's not Holyoke, so you need to tap into that. In Randolph, we're working right now with an update on their master plan, and it was amazing. Their planner was a member of the implementation committee as a resident of the last master plan. She wasn't even a planner. And since then, she's become a planner, is now the town planner over there. And it got started because they said, we need a committee to make this stuff happen, and she volunteered, and the next thing you know, there's streetscape improvements going on and other things. So I think when you look around at people, they're all here. It's just tapping and saying, could you just help us out a few nights a week, every once in a while, help push these things together. The pieces are here, and I think you're gonna be very successful.
Okay, make sure to keep our feet to the fire. Make sure we're moving forward. So I'm sorry, we're out of time for this big discussion, but we will stay for one-on-one questions afterwards. So I want to thank you all for coming out this evening. I want to thank the